Our speakers are Ken and Karen.
Paul.
Paul, thank you. Suddenly I was blanking. And Karen is the outreach coordinator for the Central Virginia Beekeepers Association, the local beekeepers group. And Ken also belongs to the same club. He's a level 2 beekeeper, or as they call them, journeyman master beekeeper. And if you don't know what that is, you can ask Ken afterwards. So they've been doing this for 20 years this year. So, and they work with the downtown Discovery Museum bees. They take care of those bees. And they also take care of what I like to call our bees. They're not really ours, but they live here when it's warm enough from April to November in the barn. And they take care of us. And I'm very grateful for that. And so without further word, I'm going to turn it over to Ken. He's going to start.
All right, so to start off, I've got to ask, who out here is going to admit to being a beekeeper? All right, so the reason I was asking that is with beekeepers, if you ask a beekeeper, three beekeepers, the same question, you'll get a minimum of 5 answers. Okay? And all of them are going to be right or wrong, given the circumstances. Which leads me to the next thing. Any questions you ask me today or any other beekeeper, frequently the first 2 words you'll hear back is, it depends. And it's not because beekeepers can't take a stand on anything. A lot of stuff in beekeeping depends on the season, depends on the strength of the colony. There's never a straight answer. It's always, well, it depends on this and this, different factors.
And it's always, all beekeeping is local. And local can be local within a 2-mile radius. So, you know, it's not, local is here at Ivy Creek. The bees here or downtown are different depending on the conditions.
So I'm sure all of you are aware that, you know, bees in the world today are under a lot of stress. So the honeybee in particular has sort of become the poster child of any cause that you want to have or any product you want to sell. So this was just a few that I put up here. The one up here at the top, Häagen-Dazs ice cream. Häagen-Dazs, as the colony collapse disorder that we'll talk about later started occurring, Häagen-Dazs did a lot with advertising about the plight of the bee, raising money for research. Now, all of it wasn't altruistic, because at the time, Häagen-Dazs was having market share issues, and they were looking for a new advertising approach to get more sales. Well, the honeybee became a perfect thing to use, and it did work. One of the items up there was from Bayer Chemical Company that makes a lot of insecticides, and they have a thing about saving the bee as well. They actually do a lot of money for research. I think they even have a park, like a...
That's kind of your amusement park kind of approach.
But if you make and sell insecticides, you have an image problem, right? So saying that you also are trying to take care of the honeybee is probably a good thing to do.
But they give a lot of money, and a lot of the best of the research is supported by Bayer.
The one that's up here that is kind of my current favorite, you might not have seen, but it was a cannabis grower, a marijuana grower, that had about Save the Bees and, you know, bees being a big part of cannabis production, which is kind of odd when you know that cannabis is wind pollinated and the flowers basically don't give any nectar. So there's nothing to attract the bees to it. But I understand that there are insects that feed on the plants that produce a sticky substance. Ants will harvest it. Bees will at times as well. It's called honeydew. So I understand that one enterprising cannabis farmer in particular baited his crop with sugar water to attract the bees. Well, the bees would also get honeydew from the insects and produce honey. So then he would sell his honey as cannabis honey. Now, there's no indication that there's any of the chemical THC that's actually in the honey. But he is selling his honey, depending on quantity that you buy, between $75 and $95 a pound. And honeydew honey is a poor quality honey, so you're paying a lot of money.
And that's part of what got us involved, is it becomes important that people become smart consumers about all of this.
And I should have said at the beginning too, we welcome questions as we go along. If you have a follow-up question on something or something that doesn't make sense, please yell it out and get my attention or Karen's attention. So we're going to do a little historical snapshot of the honeybee in the U.S., which is pretty representative of the world as a whole. And we're going to actually start 100 million years ago. But then we're going to come up to the colonial period, and most of our time is going to be spent in the last 30 years, what the situation is today. So what you're seeing here is an amber fossil of a creature that is half wasp and half bee. It was found, this is from the mid-Cretaceous period. The important thing about that period in time that started about 145 million years ago is that in the early to mid period there was an explosion in floral diversity. So the question was why? Why then? Well, at the time there were wasps, but at the beginning of the period there were wasps but not bees. Wasps are basically carnivores. They don't do much with regards to nectar and pollen. From the wasps, bees started to develop. They would take on attributes to actually collect pollen for food. So they started becoming more vegetarians rather than carnivores. And that allowed plant reproduction to go on. So, you know, what was the chicken and what was the egg? You know, what started first, the floral diversity and then the bee or the floral diversity? We don't know. But both occurred in the same time period. Scientists, of course, have to look at everything as a glass half empty. The creature here is a male, and they were very disappointed that it wasn't a female because they could have learned more about the biology. So if we look at today, wasps and bees have separated off, and this is indicating the big difference between the two families. So here's a bumblebee, and you can tell that it's very hairy, it's kind of chunky, has wide legs. Everything is designed to go out and collect pollen, also to get nectar. Whereas the wasps are pretty slim. They always have this little narrow waist here, but they're really built more for speed and for, because they're, you know, touching other insects. They are scavengers quite a bit. So they do some pollinating, but it's mostly accidental pollinating.
And the relevance on all that is that, you know, again, in terms of those that are afraid of bees and wasps, your yellow jackets and so forth, it's a wasp. They're in different places than your bee. A bee is a vegetarian. They're really not interested in stinging you. They're after plants. You're not particularly of interest to them.
So bees come in all varieties, and not just bees that do pollinating. So things that you would see around here at Ivy Creek, for instance, there's the orchard mason bee, which is a bee, but it's a solitary bee. Each female handles her own nest. A hornet, which is on a flower blossom here. A pollus wasp. Here is actually a fly. Even though it looks like a bee, it's a fly. We don't often think of flies as pollinators, but they actually do. Here at Ivy Creek, there are a number of pawpaw trees that are out here. In fact, I think there's one off of the pollinator garden, if I remember right. For whatever reason, the pawpaw tree didn't develop the idea of attracting bees with something sweet and juicy. Instead, the flowers are stinky, and it tends to attract flies. So if you want to be a pawpaw farmer and want to maximize your pollination, you should gather up roadkill and bring it to your orchard to attract more flies so that you get better pollination. Then the bumblebee, yellow jacket, and our favorite honeybee.
Is fly accidental pollination?
It is. So yeah, I'm glad you asked that. So remember I said bees were hairy. We'll talk in a few minutes that bees need pollen for food. Flies, wasps, they don't need pollen for food. Butterflies don't need pollen for food.
Hummingbirds
don't need it for food. But when they visit flowers, some pollen gets on them and is accidentally transferred from flower to flower. But the bee is taking massive amounts of pollen with it as it's going, by comparison.
Because of the fur?
Because of the hairs. Later on, I'm going to show you a picture of a bee covered with pollen to give you an idea. So if we look at where the honeybee developed in the world, basically Africa, the Mideast, Europe, on into the Caucasus areas. But is there a part of the world that you don't see? The Northern Hemisphere, Western. So when the colonists came to Jamestown, they were disappointed not to find honeybees here in America. They were everywhere else. Why wouldn't they be here? You know, it was just expected that they were going to be here. So in 1621, in November of 1621, a number of what was called skeps, they were straw baskets of bees, were loaded onto a ship, transited the Atlantic. It reached Jamestown in March of 1622. Some of the colonies survived the trip, and that's how the honeybee first came here. Later, bees were also brought in by the pilgrims up in the Northeast, but the first was into Jamestown. So we always talk about bad things that we bring into the country. In fact, we're going to talk about some of those bad things as we go along today. But really, the honeybee was an invasive species when it was brought here. It was not native, and it readily expanded its range here, and it used resources that other things did before it was here. So the question comes about is, all right, what about the native pollinators? You know, what did the honeybee do to the native bee populations? And this is a question that's really hard to answer with regards to impact, because we really don't have a count of what the bumblebees were and the mason bees. We don't have a count of what it was before they came. What we can study is what is the impact on other pollinators that are in a particular region that honeybees are in. And there is an impact on the number of flower visits by things like bumblebees when there are honeybees in the same area. They outcompete. We'll talk about why in a few minutes, but the honeybee outcompetes the native pollinators. That doesn't mean the native pollinators are left with nothing. What they tend to do is they may forage at slightly different times of the day or at different temperatures. When the honeybees aren't, they may visit crops that, or plants that the honeybees aren't actively foraging on. So they will, you know, not mess with the stuff that the honeybees are on and go to something else. So it doesn't appear that the honeybee being here from a competition point of view is causing that much of an impact on the native pollinators. There have been some disease transmission between honeybees and native bees that has occurred, but it probably would have occurred at some point anyway.
There were bumblebees here before Jamestown?
Yes.
There's honeybees that did that.
Right, the bumblebees and the orchard mason bees and a variety of others were native here.
You could make the claim that it expands pollination to different crops because of that competition.
So maybe it's worth a moment as to why the colonists even cared to bring them here. I mean, they had pollinators here. Why did they care about bringing the honeybee? The real number one reason was a lack of wax. Back then, wax was used to waterproof things, your boots, parts of your clothing. It was used to lubricate parts. It was added to animal tallow and making candles. So none of the native pollinators produce wax. That's from honeybees that we get that. Now, they also wanted the sweetener. We also don't get honey from any of the native pollinators. So they wanted that too, but really the number one reason was wax. And later, the honeybees did so well here, we learned about the colonies exporting tobacco to England, but they also exported wax. You don't always read about that in the textbook. So, The chart that I have here is from the year 2000, because it's the last, the latest I can find out on the web to show it in this format. But before I go into it, the number here at the bottom is $14.5 billion is the value of the honeybee to American agriculture. That number today, 17 years later, is about $19 billion. So tremendous impact on agriculture. And you'll see something like almonds. It's 100% dependent on insect pollination and 100% dependent on the honeybee. So if the honeybee was never brought here, had never arrived here, almonds could not have been grown in California.
And roughly 85% of the almonds in the world are grown here.
But corn doesn't need honeybees, so we could all eat corn.
As if you're back to the colonists and their native bees, if we wanted to survive on the three sisters, your squash, beans, and corn, and all had 5 acres, then we could probably get by on our native pollinators. But you throw out strawberries, watermelons, citrus, everything else. And we'd eat those things from November to March.
So let's look at for a moment as to what makes the honeybee such a great pollinator. You know, why is it such a good deal compared to bumblebees and orchard mason bees? First off, honeybees are.
If we didn't have bumblebees, we can't have apples and honey.
That's right. You know that from your school, don't you? We've been to her school, and she remembers that. So that's right. You learned. So honeybees are what's called a social insect, which means that they live together in a family group. Bumblebees are also a social bee, but not all bees are social. The orchard mason bee that we mentioned earlier is a solitary bee. But in the case of honeybees, where it says it's a large family group, a large colony of honeybees, you're talking 40 to 50,000 or more members in the colony. To put that into perspective, a large bumblebee colony might have 300. And of course, the orchard masons are solitary. So sheer numbers that make up that family group causes them to have a tremendous need for food. They also are excellent communicators. So has anyone heard about the dance that honeybees do? Okay. So honeybees communicate not only through dance, but also through pheromones or smells in the air. But they're able to communicate where food is. So when you go into the grocery store, you can see, you'll see wildflower honey, but have you noticed you see clover honey? Or you'll see buckwheat honey? Have you ever thought about why we can actually get clover honey or buckwheat honey? That's because a colony, when it sends out scouts looking for a food source, they come back and communicate that to their family unit, their hive, as to where they found this great source of nectar or this great source of pollen. So they recruit more of their numbers to go to the same place. And that continues. As more foragers come back, when it's a good source, they're continually recruiting the rest of the hive. And a hive of honeybees will work a nectar source or a pollen source until they exhaust it. So if you've got a great nectar source, like we have tulip poplars here around Ivy Creek. Tulip poplars is actually the number one nectar source in central Virginia for bees. So the bees love those flowers. When they're in bloom, they are working those blooms. So a lot of other stuff that's blooming is not being worked at the same time. Your bumblebees.
Food for your bumblebees, right, or any of your other bees at that time.
So the beekeeper actually will harvest the honey at the end of these blooms, and that's how we get a floral source honey.
And why, when we have our taste honey, why I have over there distinctive honey types that you can taste the difference. And they're specific. There's over 300 varieties, typical varietals of honey that you can, there's a bunch of others from an individual beekeepers as well, but there are over 300 varietals of honey that you can deal with. Yeah.
If, like this year, with some blooms, some plants blooming early, does that affect the bees, the honeybees, and their collection methods or ability to collect or any implications?
So it does, and throughout the year this happens. Rain at the wrong time has a big impact on the nectar sources the honeybee can use. You'll notice the tulip poplar honey is a darker colored honey. Number of years, we don't get any of that tulip poplar honey at all, and it's because the rain has hit when those blooms are open up in the tree, and because the flower opens up, the rain washes all the nectar out. And so the years that we only get light colored honey, we know it's the rain that's impacted. With the cold that we're having, the plants that the bees are working now on our warm days, like we had in February, it's really being used for them to build up. None of the floral sources that have been blooming now do we actually make a honey crop from.
You'll note a typical apple blossom honey, they work apple blossoms. You'll never get Virginia apple blossom. You would think as many apple trees as we have, you'll never get Virginia apple blossom honey. Your apple blossom honey will be New York apple blossom. And that's because the apple blossoms, when they bloom in Virginia, the bees are using that nectar to raise young. So we never get a honey crop off of it. By the time it's up there, there are other things, and they make honey off of it.
Something else to see here with a social insect. Single members of a social insect community cannot survive on its own. And that's very different than solitary bees. So they can only survive together. And in the case of the honeybees, all of the females in the colony, of which most of the members of the colony are female, they go through winter together. So going into winter, we may have a colony the size of 30-some thousand bees going into winter together. They need to have food stored to support that number. So again, this gets back into why the honeybee is so good. They have a need to collect that nectar and that pollen for food through the winter. Our bumblebee colonies, they don't have that same need. The queen is provisioned to go through the winter herself, burrowed down in the ground, but the colony as a whole does not go through winter. So they don't have the need to collect so much pollen and nectar throughout the year. They only have to have it for the time that they're active as a colony. Very little is required to provision a single bee to get through the winter. So here's the members of the honeybee colony. So most of the colony are workers. And, you know, I'm sorry to tell you guys, a lot of people think it's the males that do the work for the colony. That's not true. All the workers are female. The queen is female. So if we took DNA from a worker and DNA from a queen and actually looked at it, all we would know is that we have a female honeybee. No knowledge of whether it's a worker or a queen. The way that we got a queen was based on what the female larva was fed. Have you heard of something called royal jelly? That's the food of queens. So a female larva that's destined to be a queen is fed an exclusive diet of this royal jelly. The larva grows very rapidly, and part of what develops is the reproductive system. The workers, after being fed a little bit of royal jelly at the beginning, are fed a combination of honey and pollen, which we call bee bread. That does not allow that reproductive system to develop. The food is not the appropriate amino acids and proteins and stuff to allow that to develop. So even though they're genetically female, they aren't able to mate because the reproductive system didn't develop. And then we've got the drones down here. So if we have a colony of, say, 40,000 members, only about 500 maximum, and usually less than that, are going to be males. And males do no work for the colony at all. I think that's why they're called a drone. Their only function is to mate with unmated queens. And that occurs in the air away from the hive. Any males that a particular colony raises is not for their own use. It's really a gift to bees as a whole in the environment to provide for unmated queens from a different hive.
So they don't, a queen doesn't mate with males from her own hive. Which is the interesting part about that is everything that goes on inside a colony of bees is for the survivability of that colony. The exception being drones. Drones are a gift to the species.
How do you know it's a queen?
Look at, see how it's longer?
Well, I tell you what, we actually have bees here today, and everyone's going to get to answer that question about how we know it's a queen as to how she looks. So, yeah, we do have a hive of bees here with us today. We're going to show you. The drones don't even feed themselves. They beg for food. Usually as I go through this, so feel free, particularly all the wives that are out there, mutter the word husband. You know, I hear that constantly, so feel free.
They don't feed themselves, they don't pick up after themselves, they eat a lot, they make a mess.
So guys, we can at least say evolution had it made for us, right? This is why we're the way we are. All right, so we talked about the bees and pollen earlier. So this is a honeybee covered in hair. I don't know if you can tell here, even the eyes have hair on it. There's really no part of the bee that doesn't take advantage of having hairs on it. And this is a bee that's been visiting flowers, and you notice all of these granules of pollen are all over it like this. The hairs are electrostatically charged. So you know how you shuffle across carpet or something and you get kind of a shock if you touch things? That's electrostatic charge. The bee's hairs all have that. So the pollen grabs a hold of these hairs. You know, it's attracted to them. And from there, the bee can actually groom them to the back leg. Sometimes you'll see bees with these sort of sacks of pollen on the back legs. It has taken all of those granules that we saw here and uses its legs to groom them back and tucks them down into these little stiff hair baskets on the back legs to hold that pollen, and then it can take it back to the hive. But when you have all of this pollen on you and you're going from flower to flower, some naturally drops off. There's even some transfer of pollen back in the hive between bees. So some cross-pollination actually occurs in the hive, as opposed to just going flower to flower.
They've also recently done studies that the flowers themselves, that electrostatic charge changes in the flower if a bee is visited. So a bee can fly over and see that the charge has changed, so it doesn't waste time going to those flowers. Somebody's already been there.
Wow.
So then I'm going to hit on swarming, and I'm doing this specifically for you, Bruce, because Bruce is always interested in swarming. So as a superorganism, So the superorganism has the ability to reproduce as a superorganism, not just reproduction within the colony itself. Particularly in the spring, when there's lots of food resources coming in, there's an excess for what that colony needs. They're raising lots of young. They have the ability to start raising new queens. And before new queens are ready to hatch, the old queen and about half the bees will fly out and go off and find a new home and leave the existing colony to the new queen to come. That's a little different than most of us humans do. You know, most of us send our kids out in the world and we keep the house, but honeybees are the other way around. house and mom leaves. But that's because the existing hive is the one with the highest probability of surviving the next winter. Starting a new home from scratch is a resource-intensive thing to do, and there's a fair probability that it won't survive the first winter. So you want to risk the old queen, make sure the existing colony is the one that's going to survive. But around here at Ivy Creek, you may see masses of bees around here like this. It's possible they've come from our observation hive, although we try to not let that happen. But if you see that, please let someone know that you've seen it, and don't panic. Bees are in a good mood when they swarm. You know, life is good. We're on an adventure.
Bees only stay for defensive reasons. At this point, they have nothing to defend. They don't have a home to defend. They don't have young to defend. So there's no reason to be upset.
So what time of year does this happen?
Usually in the spring.
At my house on Easter Sunday.
Yeah.
Always on Easter Sunday.
Now,
usually when the ham's in the oven.
Now, having said that, we've had the observation hive at the Discovery Museum swarm on the 4th of July, and I'm pretty sure that's not spring, they will do it other times.
The barn tried to swarm, Barn Museum, or bees here, tried to swarm
earlier this week,
mm-hmm. when it was warm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they changed their minds. Every now and then, a colony, the queen says, you know, y'all are crazy. You know, this is just not the time to go, and she won't go. So the bees will swarm out. Where did mom go? And then they'll go back to the hive. That's what happened this time. All right, so now we're going to jump to 1987, and this is where beekeeping changed not only in our country, but for the world. Just the dates were different as to when different countries were impacted. So the mite that you see here, Varroa destructor, that's kind of a neat name, right? So it's known as the vampire mite, so it fits. This was a host of a cousin of the honeybee in East Asia. It was in the Philippines, Malaysia, places like that. And that mite developed with a bee called Apis serrana, this cousin of the honeybee, so that the pest and the host were in balance with each other. The bee had methods for dealing with the population of the mite, but the mite was able to reproduce and feed off of the Apis serrana. The life was kind of good. But then in the early 60s, 1960s, some honeybee colonies, which is Apis mellifera, remember, so this was Apis serrana, was the host for this mite. These honeybee colonies were brought in for pollination reasons near to where there were some Apis serrana colonies. And the mite was able to jump host. That's very rare to happen. Usually there's a balance and the life cycles just for a new host just doesn't fit the pest. But in this case it did. But the honeybee never developed with this mite, so it had no defenses for it. Very rapidly in our country here, over 90% of the wild colonies were wiped out, the feral colonies. Colonies that you see today, like out in a tree or something like that, the average expected lifespan for an unmanaged colony is about 18 months.
Which means if you're seeing honeybees in your yard, you have a beekeeper within 2 to 3 miles of you.
So these are the mites here. They actually, when the bee is developing, the female mite lays her eggs in there and her offspring feed off of the bee as it's developing. So the wounds allow other viruses and stuff to come in, so it's really a bad deal for the bees.
And at this point, honeybees became domesticated, classified as domesticated animals. They can't survive without human intervention.
Then in 2006, we thought the world was going to come to an end. You remember all of the press about the disappearing bees? It was called colony collapse disorder. Colony collapse disorder is not actually a disease, it's a phenomenon. It's just a description for something that was happening, but it's not a disease per se that you can actually treat. But colonies were disappearing at an alarming rate. A commercial beekeeper in the U.S. was the first one to sort of raise his hand and say, you know, something's not right with my hives. he had visited hives that he was overwintering. He had been there several weeks before, came back out to look at them, no bees. He was going hive after hive. He would either find no bees in there or find the queen and just a few worker bees in there. No dead bees anywhere.
And we're talking, he showed up and found 400 hives gone. So we're not talking one or two, we're talking 400.
So, and then beekeepers from all over started reporting the same thing. And for the next several years, it got worse and worse. So everyone was kind of in a panic to figure out what was going on. And very quickly, there were all sorts of theories. One that was quickly debunked was that extraterrestrials would come and steal the bees and take them. So we found that out pretty quickly. Cell phone towers. It actually took two major studies to eliminate cell phone towers as a possibility, because they were worried about electromagnetic radiation affecting the bees' ability to navigate. Because remember I said that this beekeeper didn't find any dead bees? If there had been things like pesticides or something like that, there would have been a carpet of dead bees everywhere. But there wasn't. So there's this thought that, okay, they flew off and they couldn't find their way back. So thankfully, it wasn't cell phone towers. I don't know what we'd have done as a society if it had been cell phone towers. You know, phone or food? I'm not sure. You know, I'm not sure where the
probably an age out. Thing might have happened. Teenager.
So all sorts of things we were worried about with pesticides, and just there were theories everywhere. And so there were lots of news stories about we found it. And the answer didn't last very long before it was, oh, that wasn't it. So we'll get to what the current thought is in a few slides. Now, if we look at something very, very new, so this was February of this year, the first bumblebee in the continental U.S., like first bumblebee in any of the U.S., was put on the endangered species list. The rusty-patched bumblebee. If we go back a decade ago, I think we would have found the rusty-patched bumblebee throughout Ivy Creek. So Virginia was part of its range. But just a decade later, from the point where it was very common, over 85% of its range and its number of colonies are gone. I mean, a tremendous decline in this bumblebee in just a decade of time.
Does the mite affect bumblebees also?
So, okay, great question. So, I'll use it depends. The mite has been found on individual bumblebees, the Varroa mite, but the bumblebee biology is such that the mite cannot reproduce in it. So it's really not able to infect the colony. There's individuals. It's been, like I said, found on individuals, could cause some issues, but mostly it uses the bumblebee to hitch a ride to somewhere else and drops off. The mite doesn't have the ability to fly or anything, so it depends on other things for mobility.
But they ruin honeybee colonies, and so now they're only survive if they're domesticated, and so we have a slide coming up. I don't want to be a spoiler on that, but that's how a beekeeper keeps his hive alive with mites.
All right, so we don't have a slide about that in particular, but beekeepers have to manage our hives to look at what is the load, what we call it the load, how many mites per 100 bees are there in a hive. And we have to make life and death choices for that hive as to whether we are going to intervene and treat them with something or not. And if not, the answer is probably the colony is not going to survive. There's a variety of things that we use. Some are more organic in nature, mechanical. There are some chemical treatments. So you have to make decisions based on the state of the colony.
Otherwise, there would be no more honeybees.
There will always be certain colonies that are going to be more resistant to others. Just like there's still some American chestnut trees throughout the country. Not many, but there's still a few survivors. And it would be the same way.
And certainly not enough to continue agriculture in the way that we do. Agriculture in this country.
So, that slide said that this is true of bumblebees, but not
bees. That bumblebee.
Okay.
The last slide said there was one bumblebee.
That particular bumblebee.
That particular species of bumblebee.
Okay.
Okay.
Others are under pressure, but this is the worst case of bumblebees.
And it's the first of the bees that has made that list.
So we can look to a province in China to give us an idea of what life would be like without bees for pollination. The province of Sichuan really took no care of its environment at all. Just indiscriminate use of pesticides, all sorts of toxic things. It didn't manage the colonies right. Bees basically aren't there at all. And the beekeepers there in China won't even bring their hives in for pollination purposes because often their hives won't survive after bringing them in. But you know, as luck would have it, this area of China is famous for its pear trees. There are families there that for many generations have had these pear trees. So what do you do if you don't have pollinators? Well, you become a pollinator yourself. So they actually have to go up the trees twice. That when the pollen, when flowers are opening, they will go up the tree with these bamboo poles and feathers and collect pollen from all of the blossoms and bring it back down, dry it, let it dry for about 2 or 3 days. Then they go back up the tree again and use their feather and pollinate all of the flowers. So that's how they get, they still have a pear crop at this place. So if you could imagine doing this in our country, you know, if this is what we had, I don't think it would work out very well. Whole Foods is another company that's done a lot of advertising is not the right word, but marketing for with regards to bees. They actually went into their produce area of a store and the dairy area of a store, and they took out all the items that you would either lose or lose most of out of those sections of the store just to give you an idea of what the store would look like. So you can see there's an awful lot of produce that's missing and an awful lot of dairy that's missing. So, you know, why dairy? You know, cows don't get pollinated by insects. Why dairy?
Because of what the cows eat.
Exactly right. So two of the major food sources for cattle production are clover and alfalfa. And both of those, for seed production, they have to be intensively pollinated by bees. So you lose your seed production. So there's even an impact there. So that's an indirect impact as opposed to a direct impact like not having an apple. The blossom wasn't pollinated and you didn't get your apple. If you can imagine the pressure that it would put on our society if we had this amount of food disappear. Basically, a third of the food you eat every day depends on honeybee pollination, not just insect pollination. So if we lost that, you can think about taking a third of our food supply out, what that would mean for people in general. It would be pretty tough, I think. So now we're going to look at environmental stressors. So when we're looking at CCD, remember I said all the things we decided that it wasn't? It turned out, it looks like it's a combination of things together. So there's four basic categories of effects that were impacting the honeybee. And I'm going to go over each of them. So there were pests, pathogens, pesticides played a role, and nutrition. And even when colony collapse disorder wasn't the ultimate result of all of this, just some of these have very negative impacts on the colonies and hurts their survival. So two pests, we already talked about the Varroa mite here. That is by far the worst problem that we have from a pest perspective.
Effectively, we've gotten to the point that even with the whole CCD thing, most of the beekeepers' theory is that if we could handle the mite, we'd be so much better off that CCD would take care of. That's not our problem, that our problem really is the mite. If we could solve that one, we'd be in good shape.
Another pest that has been brought over in the past few years from South Africa was the small hive beetle. It came here in fruit, shipments of fruit, and this beetle flies. So it doesn't need anything to sort of hitch a ride on to move around. When hives are weakened, by things like dealing with the varroa mite, the hive beetles get going. And see all these little maggots down in here?
Yes.
The female lays just thousands of eggs and they hatch into these little maggots. And worse yet, those maggots put out a slime on the comb that is a bee repellent.
Oh.
So it, with too many of the beetles in there, it'll actually cause a colony to abscond, leave its home. And then pathogens. So we as humans, you know, we suffer from things like bacteria and viruses and fungi, and so do honeybees. Remember I said the varroa mite feeds on the developing young? Those wounds give avenues for viruses to invade the bees. And one of the viruses is called the formed wing virus. So this is a bee that was fed on as a larva, and that deformed wing virus got into it through a wound, and that kept its wings from actually forming. So this bee has hatched, it's unable to fly, and it will just die. So it's, when a lot of this is happening, the colony is losing strength from this. So now let's talk about pesticides. So when remember I said the commercial beekeeper was the first one that found, you know, his hives had disappeared. He was sure that it was because of a new class of pesticide that had come on the market. It was a neonicotinoid, because his bees for the first time had been in fields that had been treated that way. All the scientific evidence at the moment doesn't say that alone can cause this kind of problem, but pesticides in general are a factor. But if we look at something that was done in the European Union, particularly in France, a lot of beekeepers did a lot of lobbying with the government. There were protests, all sorts of stuff, to ban neonicotinoids from being used. And the European Union did that back in 2013. All of the evidence I can find so far has shown no change in the number of colonies lost by beekeepers. You know, they thought by taking the pesticide off the market that their colonies, they wouldn't be losing so many. Hadn't happened. It's so far state level.
That's not what you're going to see in most of the literature, however. Like if you Google it, it's going to be come up over and over again.
So one thing happens here is I like to call the law of unintended consequences. So the farmers in the European Union, they still had to grow crops. So they had now lost a whole class of pesticides that they were using. So they went back to using pesticides that they had used previously. And the reason that they had stopped using those previously is because they weren't as effective anymore. So they were going to this new class. So in going back to these other chemicals that were often more toxic than the neonicotinoids, they used them more frequently, and they used them in higher dosages. So that had very bad impacts on all the pollinators in the area there too. So just banning that chemical didn't solve the problem, because it's pesticides in general is an issue. And then nutrition. When we think of nutrition, we immediately start thinking about monoculture versus diversity. Because if you think about how we do agriculture in this country, we grow thousands of acres of the same crop. Almonds is a perfect example. There's like 780,000 acres of almonds. And all those trees come into bloom at the same time. That's right. So bees that are brought there for pollination, that's all they're getting, you know, as a food source, is those almond blossoms. But we really, as far as the impact of nutrition, we're not seeing it so much from a diversity versus monoculture thing. There are periods of time in different areas that plants don't give as much nectar and pollen. There are periods of what we call dearth, where there isn't anything for the bees. Drought years impacts certain plants. So a lot of our nutritional issues just occur based on environmental conditions, not just the way that we grow the crops.
And this is really where individuals can make huge differences. A honeybee makes a 12th of a teaspoon of honey in her entire lifetime. That's not a lot. Your pot of flowers or your yard can be the answer to keeping this kind of thing from happening. You can be the diversity They travel, what, 2.5 to 3 miles. They can find your yard. So you can, it's the pot of flowers on your balcony can make those kinds of differences.
So I put this quote up here about, I thought it was interesting, Nipkin is known as the Sage of Baltimore. He's a journalist from the past. But when we were looking at colony collapse disorder, there just had to be a simple answer, something we could easily treat. But it turned out all of those simple answers were wrong. It's a very complex problem with multiple facets that we have to worry about. So there's no pill to take to solve it. I'm an engineer, and for engineers, we have what's called a KISS principle. Keep it simple, stupid. So this is counter at that point, so I have to unthink being an engineer. So the way sort of ask ourselves, is our honeybees kind of being the canary in the coal mine with regards to our environment and what we're doing to it? Time is going to tell that way. The situation with the rusty patched bumblebee is a little disconcerting, you know, having an actual bumblebee now on the endangered species list. So we're going to have to look. So we all need to be good stewards of our environment. So we have a few things here. All right, well, what can you do? You know, so one thing you can do, are most of you gardeners out here? We have a lot of gardeners. All right, so if you're gardening, when those vegetable plants are done, let them go to seed. Let them bloom, because a lot of those crops are pollinated by bees for seed production commercially anyway, so leave that for them there. When you're looking at what flowers and perennials and herbs and stuff that you're planting, pay attention to the ones that are actually attractive to pollinators. Azaleas are something that really isn't attractive for bees, and we have our azaleas at home, you know, that we say they're our plants. But we make sure at our house that we plant a lot of things that are pollinator friendly, that attract pollinators. And it's not just the honeybees, you know, it's the butterflies.
And there's a lot of things that you don't even think. Again, our main honey crop is a tulip popper. A lot of them are trees and things that are not as obvious. And we need things that are, we lose bees to starvation on, really in March, okay? So anything that blooms really early or really late. Our main honey crop, honey flow, is from the end of March to the 15th of June, which means anything that's blooming outside of that time frame is food for, they're not getting anything. So if you can have something that's blooming outside of that time frame, you're feeding pollinators.
So when we talk honey flow and stuff like this, because I'm sure you're thinking, you know, I see bees on my flowers all through the summer and the fall. You know, I see them all there. When we're talking about a honey flow and making a honey crop, we're seeing the weight of the colony increasing during that time. We have one of our members of our bee club has a hive on a scale, and we actually track it each day as to whether it's gaining or losing weight, what was the weather that day. To give you an idea of what the honeybee's capable of, I think the highest amount of weight gain in a single day that was seen on his hive was 28 pounds. If you can imagine squeezing nectar out of flowers and sucking it up with a straw and get 28 pounds of it, it's pretty amazing. But around the 15th of June, give or take a week, I mean, it's a very tight margin there, the weight of the colony starts going down. So even though you're seeing bees on your flowers then, they are bringing back some nectar and pollen, but it's not very much nectar and pollen. So the hive now is consuming more than they're bringing back. So honey that they have produced when it was really good, they're actually starting to consume it to make up for the difference of what they can't bring back.
And that's the honey that they are going to make to get through the winter. We, in the state of Virginia, a colony, we leave about 70 pounds of honey on the hive for the bees to get through the winter. The average take per hive is around 30 pounds. So 70 pounds of that they have to make during that time frame.
So if the beekeeper takes too much, either the colony is not going to live the next winter, or you're going to feed it a lot of sugar water for them to make sugar water honey to get through the winter on. Actually, sugar water honey is a fine honey food source for them. If you were to eat it, you'd say it's sweet and has no taste. So it's not a good honey substitute. When you're planting, look at the heirloom varieties. So a lot of the plants that we have, these double blossoms and these types of flowers that we have, they don't tend to be as good nectar and pollen producers. The old-fashioned single flowers tend to be better. Where you can, plant your wildflower garden. All of us should think about when we're using pesticides. You know, if you don't have to use them, don't use them at all. If you have to use it, try to get something that is the least toxic choice of the choices that you have, and absolutely read the label. Several years ago, it was a federal rule that labels had to be enhanced to give you more information about the impact on pollinators for whatever you use. Some pesticides that are deadly to bees can be safely used at particular times of day or time of year, or in certain formulations, whether it's liquid or a powder. So you really need to look at the label and really believe it and follow it. You know, it shouldn't be your convenience. It's got to be according to what's on the label, or you are going to do damage to the...
And you can use them. You can have your flowers, just use them appropriately.
And you have to think a little bit beyond just what you're trying to spray. So if you're spraying your apple trees, look down on the ground as to what's growing under those apple trees. If they're being visited by bees, you've got to be concerned about that regardless of what the label says about how to spray for apples. Okay. Us local beekeepers always like being supported. So some of our local beekeepers sell honey locally, but really all these other things that you're doing here with what you plant, you're supporting your local beekeepers. And if your neighbor next door decides to have bees, think of it kindly. No? Don't think of it as a worrisome thing. And another thing is, if you look at here at Ivy Creek, you know, we're very fortunate with all of the native plants that are here and the way that this place is managed. There's an awful lot of public spaces that we don't take full advantage of today. A lot of the medium strips in our roads, right-of-ways on power lines and things like that. I think there's a lot of possibilities out there that we could take advantage of to plant for pollinators to increase the amount of forage that's out there. So with that...
We've got a honey tasting over there. I also... made up a few things with honey. I've got a couple of cookies over there to give you a sense of when you're cooking. I do a lot of substituting with honey. It's not a very exciting oatmeal cookie recipe because the point is the honey. I substituted with honey in one of them. So look at the difference and what that substitution is. It's the exact same recipe with just the honey substitution. So you'll see the two of those. I'll be over there. Ken, you're going to have...
Yeah, I'm going to have these. But before we do this, are there questions out here? Ah, okay.
So how do you know what bees are eating to make the specific honey? And do all the bees eat the same thing so that when you get clover honey, you know that it's all clover?
All right, so let me tell you, let's use clover honey as an example. All right. The majority of the clover honey is made out in the upper Midwest and into southern Canada. That's where thousands of acres of sweet clover are grown. And the soil is great out there. The plants, each individual plant, gives lots of nectar. So what a beekeeper will do is he will take his hives, he or she will take their hives there to the clover crop with boxes of comb that they're empty. So the comb has no nectar or honey in them at that point. Puts the bees there. Now you remember I said that bees go out and recruit their whole colony to work a good source? these clover flowers is a great nectar source. So very quickly, that hive is concentrated on visiting the clover flowers and bringing that nectar back. So they are making honey almost exclusively off of clover blossoms at that point. At the point in time where the blossom is ending on the clover, the beekeeper goes and harvests those boxes separately. So they're set aside separately, harvested together, and what you're left with there is almost exclusively clover honey. You know, is there the random dandelion and stuff like that in there? It will be, but predominantly it will be clover. And the same story is true for all of these other honeys that you see.
And the beekeeper, so you know what's blooming, and you pull it off at that time, and you also, or you know roughly what clover honey looks like. So you, and you know what it tastes like, and so that's how we kind of manage to know. For instance, you'll see over there we have locust and tulip poplar. They are blooming pretty close to the same time frame. They look totally different. So one's really light, one's tulip poplar is a classic red color. So if I get a hive, one hive has really reddish honey, one has really clear yellow honey, and I pull them off at the same time. Here, one of them's going to be locust and one of them's going to be tulip poplar.
And the tulip poplar is blooming only in a short window of time, and there aren't orchards of them. So isn't it more likely to be contaminated with what else they can find in the area?
All right, so let's take the tulip poplar trees as an example. There are a lot of tulip poplars around here, probably far more than you realize that are out there. The flowers give so much nectar, they're very attractive to honeybees. So if they're there, they're going to work that type of blossom. And it's not just the single tree that they're getting the whole group to work. All the trees in the area are also being worked. So once they're of the mindset, they understand the smell of that nectar. Because part of the communication that's brought back by the scouts is they actually share taste of what they found. So the taste and the aroma, they understand the nectar that they're looking for. So they're mostly going to work that. Now, did some other scouts go out and this one found, besides, rather than the tulip poplar, it found a wild blackberry? Maybe. And as it comes back, but it's not going to be as successful recruiting as many members of the hive to work back
and then he'll
as the
ones shift, with the tulip. Then she'll shift over.
And clover, don't they bloom for a long time? So if someone brings their hives in for clover, will we rotate them to something else for their nutrition? And people will come in during that same season?
Right, or to get a different honey crop. But again, as they go to move them, harvest that separately. Because if your next stop is, if you went to a buckwheat field, for instance, is the next thing you're going to do.
The other thing is, remember we're talking, theoretically what you could do if you wanted it to be isolated, it's a 2 to 3 mile radius. So you're talking 8,600 acres. What you would have to do is plop your hive down in the middle of 8,600 acres with nothing else in order to get only one thing. We don't have to do that because of the way bees work. The bees recruit and are very efficient. They only shop one grocery store. You know, they just, once they figure it out, it would be inefficient to do anything else. They found a good source, so they only go to the same place. So we don't have to do that.
And it was to the plant's advantage to develop in such a way to make their flowers more attractive than others, because you're getting pollinated by granules of pollen from a blackberry plant. If you're a tulip poplar tree, it doesn't work. So you want to make sure that they're visiting other